So, yeah, we are talking about non-commutative distributions in operator-valued case. And last time I formulated in an abstract way what we mean with a distribution. So I mean, up to now, distributions was just a collection of moments, but maybe it's better to really formalize this in an abstract way, putting the moments all on the same object so that we can also compare various distributions. Okay, so here's the definition. Let me recall it from last time. So I mean, the distributions are now linear functionals on the non-commutative polynomials in one variable x, but the coefficients are coming from B. So the setting is B is in our case always a unital C-star algebra, so that we have some analysis, and then we defined B of x. So this is the, so x is here a formal variable, and these are the polynomials in x, but the coefficients are coming from B. So this means these are linear combinations of monomials, and the monomials are products of the x's, but we can multiply B's everywhere in between. And elements and B, elements from B and elements from x don't commute in general. Of course, everything, so there's a one here, which of course commutes with the x. But otherwise, there's no commutation relation. Okay, and so on this object, we define our non-commutative distributions, or maybe let's say a B-valued distribution. So what was this? This was a linear functional from Bx to B, which satisfies a couple of properties. So in principle, I mean, if I apply mu to the monomials, this corresponds to the moments of my random variables. And so what we require here are the abstract conditions which we require of our moments in our setting. And so there were the conditions that mu is unital, so mu of 1 should be equal to 1. That's somehow the probability part, that we have a kind of probability measure. Then it should be a BB bimodule map, which means that mu of a polynomial, but where I'm multiplying with a B at the beginning and a B at the end, I can take out those elements from B. So if I have B times P of x B prime, so where P of x is an arbitrary polynomial here, but I have an element from B at the beginning and element at the end, then the bimodule property says that I can take this out. So this is the same as B times mu of P of x times P prime. So for all elements in my algebra of polynomials and for all B and B prime in B. Okay, so I mean, those elements here are somehow the constant polynomials. And then, of course, the crucial thing is that we need some positivity. Of course, if we want an analytic structure, I mean, we are looking on moments of self-adjoint operators, and they should have some positivity with respect to our positive conditional expectations. And this is here formulated in a way that the mu is actually a positive object. And actually, of course, we will also amplify everything not just over B, but also to matrices over B. And then, of course, the version of mu should also be positive on all matrix levels, which means essentially we have a kind of complete positivity. So mu is completely positive, which means that the amplification of mu to the matrix level of a positive element there, which then is of the form P of x star P of x, should be greater or equal than 0. For all P of x now in the matrices over polynomials in x, which means n by n matrix where the entries are polynomials. And so here I'm landing, of course, in the n by n matrices over B, and of course, this guy here should be a positive element there. But positivity in a C-star algebra, we know what this means. And this here, of course, is the amplification to the n by n matrices where I take the identity tensor mu. Okay, And if I just require those three things, then this is more or less analog of just arbitrary probability measures in a classical setting. So we gave a name to this here, so those three properties. If I have mu's which satisfy this, so I denoted these elements which satisfy this by sigma b. And this is somehow the analog of all probability measures. But in a non-commutative, I mean, this is a setting we cannot really deal with. Because this would mean we would have to look on unbounded operators, and there are many problems. So what we really will do in the following is that we add to this a condition, which in a classical means that we are dealing with compactly supported probability measures. And this is this exponential boundedness. So in addition, we also require that our mu's are exponentially bounded, which means that we have a bound m bigger than zero, such that for all b1 up to bn in b, we also have a bound on the operator norm of mu of x b1, x b2, and so on up to bn x mu of this. Okay, and the bound is, I mean, the x will essentially be replaced by an operator, and this operator should be bounded with an norm bounded by m, which means if I estimate this, then I should get a factor m for each x, and here n plus 1. So this should be smaller than m to the n plus 1. And then, of course, the size of the b will also come into it. So I also have here the norm of b1 times the norm of b2 times, and so on, the norm of bn. Okay, and this is what we call exponentially bounded. So if I have a mu which satisfies this and this exponentially boundedness condition, then we denoted this. So if I have, let's say, sigma b, so if I have a mu which is in sigma b and it satisfies this exponential boundedness, then we say mu is in sigma b zero. So I'm putting a zero here, which means I also have this condition four. And that's, in a classical case, this encodes exactly the compactly supported probability measures. And that's the class about which we hopefully can talk. Maybe you would also like to talk just about this one, but at the moment we are quite far away from this. So there are many, many problems. Good. And of course, the idea is that with those four conditions, we are encoding the moments of all possible random variables which we find in a b-valued C-star probability space. And of course, if I have such an object, then of course I can encode the distribution of my variable x in such a setting. So maybe let me put this so as the next part in the definition. So this was definition, this was part two, where I abstractly defined our non-commutative distributions. And of course, if I have a random variable, I mean, we are really interested in random variables in an b-valued C-star probability space. So let us look on such a situation. So let's say A, B, and E is a b-valued C-star probability space. And I'm looking at a self-adjoint operator there, so at a random variable. So I take an x, which is self-adjoint. This should be in A. Then, of course, yeah, we are interested in its distribution. And the distribution is given by the collection of the moments. But of course, I can also encode this now in such an abstract, in such a mapping, which really lives on this B of x. So then, the b-valued distribution of this x. So I mean, it should be clear that everything is here as operator valued. So I denote this by mu of x. That's our usual notation. So this is the distribution of our variable x. This is given by, yeah, so mu of x should now be a linear functional living on these polynomials in X. So this is our operator, capital X. This is the little x from the formal variables going to B. And of course, it is defined, of course, by taking expectations of elements here, and where I replace the little x by the capital X. So the mu x of a polynomial here, this is given by taking the e of this polynomial, where I plug in for the little x, the capital X. Of course, it is clear. If I have an abstract b-valued polynomial, it is given by sums of monomials, and the monomials are products of b's and little x's, and now I just replace the little x's by my concrete operator. Then I get an element. So this p of x here is an element in A. X is in A. So here I take sums of products of x's and elements from B, so I get something in A, and then I apply E, which is my conditional expectation from A to B. And then I get, of course, something in B. So this is really a mapping which lands here. And I can do this for all polynomial in B of x. Good. And of course, the idea is now that with this abstract setting here, in particular here, we have encoded all possible distributions of all possible self-adjoint elements in our C-star probability spaces. And of course, this is something which one should check. I mean, first of all, one should check that any such distribution of an operator satisfies these properties. But this is more or less clear. So maybe we can do this as an assignment. This is, of course, those definitions are made according to what we have there, but the other way around, it might not be so clear. The other way around is like in a classical case, if you have a sequence of numbers which have some positivity properties and they are bounded, then actually they are the moments of a probability measure. So we should have something. And of course, we don't have probability measures. We can only say we have operators whose distribution is this. So in a classical case, of course, you can realize every probability measure by some operator. Good. So let me write this down as some remarks about the connection between this abstract setting and the concrete setting. So of course, the sigma B0, abstract b-valued distributions, they should, of course, consist of all possible b-valued distributions of random variables X in some b-valued C-star probability space in b-valued C-star probability spaces. Okay, and one direction that actually every b-valued distribution of such an operator satisfies this, so its distribution is in this space, this is more or less clear, but so maybe we check this in assignments, but this is somehow straightforward. So if I have such an X, then its distribution, in this sense here, really is in sigma B0. And of course, the zero, that it is exponentially bounded, is of course the fact that I have a bounded operator here. I mean C star spaces. So all my operators X are bounded operators. So that this is there for such an X is clear. But that we also have the other direction. This is, of course, what we hope. I mean, only makes sense to make such an abstract definition if this is also is true, but of course this is not so obvious. So that's something which one has to prove, so that we also have the other direction. This is also true. and was shown in a theorem by Popa and Vinnikov a couple of years ago. And so I will write this down precisely. So the other direction was shown in the following theorem. Good, so let me write this down. So this is by Popa and Vinnikov. And maybe the ideas, of course, go already back to Voiculescu in the 90s or so, but the precise formulation in our setting is the following. Okay, so maybe... Okay, I erased this, so but you should keep in mind the four properties which we have. But I will recall them when we need them. So, here's the theorem. So, this was by Mihai Popa and Viktor Vinnikov from 2013. Yeah, and essentially we are claiming, that of course we have a B is a C star algebra. So let's say for a C star algebra B. So that's, we're looking on B-valued distributions, and of course the B is fixed. So for C star algebra B, the following are equivalent, and those are of course conditions for such a possible distribution for a linear map. We are looking on linear map mu, which goes from Bx to B. Okay, and then we want to characterize when is such a mu an element in sigma B0. And this is exactly the case if it is really the distribution of an operator-valued variable in some C star probability space. So this means that I can realize this mu as the distribution of an operator. So there exists a B-valued C star probability space A, B, and E. So this is a C star algebra where B is a subalgebra and E is a conditional expectation from A to B, and an operator there, which of course should be self-adjoint, and the self-adjoint X in A. Okay, if I have such a setting, then of course we defined what is the distribution of this guy here, mu of X, and now I'm claiming that this mu of X is then the same as the given mu. So such that the distribution of this operator is really the mu from which we started. And what I just said is that this direction, of course, is clear. But the point is, of course, to go the other way around. So if I have a mu which has abstractly some properties, so how can I realize an operator which has this distribution? Good. So I'm not giving the full proof of this, just giving you the idea. So what you should do. And of course, what you do is a kind of GNS construction. So here is a rough sketch of the proof. So in the scalar valued setting, so I mean, what can you do there if you want to realize your operator? Let's say you're given a probability measure, or maybe you're given moments, and then you realize, of course, your operator by multiplication on the polynomials. So you have the polynomials, like here, but you have the polynomials with complex numbers as constant, and then you need an operator, and this operator is given by multiplication with your formal variable x. And then you check. that everything works. But of course, you need what the crucial thing you need. You must need operators on Hilbert spaces. So you have to make a Hilbert space out of your polynomials. And of course, you are using the distribution or the probability measure for defining inner product. And this is like the GNS construction. And now we do the operator valued version of this. So everything is more, I mean, in principle, it is the same, but there are of course more technical things to check. So we do an operator valued version. So we do operator valued version of the GNS construction. So this means, so we start from the only thing which we really have, if we have mu, this is just our b-valued polynomials. So we take our b-valued polynomials, and on this we put a kind of inner product by using our mu. But this mu is now mapping not to the complex numbers, but just to b, which means the inner product is also not complex number valued, but it will be b valued. So we have a kind of Hilbert module, not a Hilbert space. Good, but anyhow, so that's can be done in the same way. So we put on b of x a b valued inner product by we have to declare what is the inner product between two polynomials. So let's say I have p of x and I have q of x. I mean, you could also just write p and q. You don't need the little x, but just to remember you that those are really formal polynomials in a formal variable. I usually write it as p of x and q of x. So this will be an inner product which depends on mu. I mean, mu is given. So, and we take mu. Yeah, so what is in a GNS construction? What do? You take the state of, you take the adjoint of this and you multiply it with this. So this is mu of p of x star q of x. So this is an element in the polynomials. We can apply mu to this, but what we get is not a number, but an element in B. Yeah, okay, so, but that's okay. I mean, there's a big theory about Hilbert modules and things like this, but of course one has to prove a couple of things. And so we have now something which is like a Hilbert space, but the inner product is not really a scalar valued guy. And on this, we would like to take as our operator multiplication with x. But of course, in the end, our operators really should be operators on a Hilbert space. So I mean, we also, at some point, we have to realize that the operators which we have are not just operators defined on Hilbert modules, but we should see that they're really coming from a C-star algebra. And for this, I mean, we need some scalar structure on this. And so what we can do is we can make out of this, we can go down to the scalars. We cannot really go down on the level of the inner product, but we can go down on the level of the norm. So we can at least put a norm now on this b of x. In the same way as usually, I mean, you get a norm out of the inner product, but we also invoke the norm on b. I mean, B is not a Hilbert space, so we cannot somehow go down, use a Hilbert in inner product in B, but we can use the norm in B to give us at least a norm on B of X. So this inner product here gives on the polynomials in X a norm, and this norm is now really an ordinary norm. So this is C valued norm. So for polynomial p of x, I have now a norm, which also depends on mu. And this is given by taking, how do you get from Hilbert space inner product a norm? You take the inner product of an element with itself, and then you take the square root. Okay, here the inner product is in B. We want to get a number, but B has a norm, so we can take now here the norm in B of this, and then take the square root. And you can check that this is really an ordinary norm. And if you now complete this guy here, the polynomials, with respect to this norm, we have at least a Banach space on which we can then use our operators as multiplication operators. Okay, so completing the polynomials in X with respect to this gives, okay, it doesn't give a Hilbert space, but at least it gives a Banach space, huh? And gives a Banach space, which maybe let me do it's B of X completed with respect to a norm coming from the mu. Okay, and on this Banach space, I can now define my multiplication operator, and then one has to check the usual things, and maybe a few more in this more technical setting, which in the end show you that you really get a bounded operator. And of course, the point is that the operators which we have there are not directly defined on a Hilbert space, so you don't really have a C-star setting. But actually, at the end, at some point, you can see that the operators you are dealing with satisfy, in a norm, the C-star property. You have here, essentially, you have a Banach algebra of operators here, but you know that a C-star algebra is determined by the fact that for your operators, you also have this property. So if by dealing with this at some point you realize that the operators which are on your Banach space actually they satisfy this, then you know that you are really in a C-star setting. So in principle you have realizations of this on a Hilbert space. Okay, and that's what happens. But for this one has to do a few technical details, so I don't really want to go into those details, but so let me just say, so what you do in principle, so on this space here, on this, you can now take your polynomials and act with them by multiplication, via left multiplication. So on this Banach space, the polynomials act via left multiplication. Okay, and then, of course, you have to check a couple of details. I mean, it's usually in the GNS construction, for example, you have to divide by the null space. You have kernels, you have to divide out by this, and you have to check that the operator, this multiplication, really is a bounded operator. But, I mean, you have enough structure there to really get this. So, checking a couple of technical details, which I don't want to do, shows then, so we see in the end, that this action of your operators from here is first of all bounded. I mean, that's what you expect, and this of course depends on the exponentially boundedness of your mapping mu. So this is bounded, but actually it is also adjointable, which means that your operators all have an adjoint, which on a Hilbert space is clear, but on this Hilbert module, this is this kind of extra property. And if you have this adjoint, that really tells you that you're in a C-star setting. So it's bounded and adjointable, and thus generates a C-star algebra. Algebra A. So you take all multiplication operators coming from B of X, and then of course you close this, and then this gives you a C-star algebra. And now you take one special multiplication operator, namely just a multiplication operator with the variable X, and this is really the one which you want. So our capital X, the operator which we want, this is now in this sister algebra. So this should be multiplication. With the formal variable x. Good, so this gives us the the algebra A, and then of course we also need the conditional expectation. But this is like in a GNS construction, I mean the state is connected with the inner product by essentially acting on the unit vector 1. And of course we also have a 1 here. So we have in this setting we also have a conditional expectation E, which goes from A to B, as it should. And this is given by the usual formula for the GNS construction, so namely, what is E of A? So what do I do? I apply A to the 1 and then take the inner product with 1. Of course, in my inner product, which is given by mu. And 1 is just the 1 in my algebra B, which is the same as the 1 in A. Okay, and of course, this inner product is B-valued. So this is really mapping from A to B. And of course, I mean, one has to check that all this makes sense and has the right properties, but this can be done. I mean, a few things are a little bit technical, but in principle, it's not so different from what you do in a scalar valued case, where you do the GNS construction for a given state. I mean, what we are given here is our mapping mu, which plays the role of the state. And of course, now you should have done things. If you do it in this way, it should now be true that the distribution of this operator x is exactly the mu from which you started as a distribution. But this is, again, this is now clear. You just have to write it down. But let us do this. Let us just check that we have done everything in the correct way. So with respect to this conditional expectation, x has now distribution mu. So let us check this. So I'm claiming that if I'm applying my conditional expectation to a polynomial in my operator x, that this gives me the mu on the corresponding formal polynomial, the mu from which I started. So let us apply the expectation to a moment. Let us look on a moment of the x. So I take the expectation of, let's say, b0, x, b1, up to x, bn plus 1. So I have to check that this actually is the corresponding mu expression. Good, so what is this by definition? This is by definition, I take the inner product of 1, and then I take this operator, so this is now b0, x, b1, and so on, x, bn plus 1, acting on 1. And now I have to see what those operators do. And of course, the b's here, they also act as multiplication operators. They are just multiplying with themselves. They are just multiplying with b. And the capital X, this was by definition the multiplication with the formal variable x. So this means, and if I'm multiplying on 1, I just reproduce this here as an abstract polynomial. So bn plus 1 on 1 is just bn plus 1. Then if I'm multiplying with my operator x, this gives me the little x times bn plus 1 and so on. And I just multiply this all together. So what I get here is 1. And I have here the b0 x b1 up to x bn plus 1. So this is now just my formal polynomial in the axis, and I have to take here, of course, the mu inner product of this. And the mu inner product is, of two guys, is taking the adjoint of this, multiplying it with this. The adjoint of 1 is 1, so, and then I take mu. So I take mu of 1 times b0 x b1 up to x Bn plus 1, yeah, which of course the 1 is the 1, so it disappears. So this is mu of b0 x b1 up to x bn plus 1. And so you see we really get what we want. The moment of this variable x is nothing else than mu applied to this corresponding formal polynomial. Okay, I mean, that's how we set up things. Because I mean, multiplication with x just means that we essentially, if we evaluate things, we replace the capital X by the little x. Yeah, so this shows us that really we have this correspondence between these abstract distributions, which are characterized by a few properties. I mean, the crucial ones is the exponential boundedness, which means that we have bounded operators, and the other, of course, is the positivity. Now, of course, positivity is somewhere hidden here. I mean, the positivity of mu is needed that my inner product is positive, because only then I can really make the usual estimates. So, I mean, positivity, I mean, it didn't really show up here, but of course, it's very important in the background. Like in ordinary GNS construction, you need the positivity of the state, because you need a positive inner product, because otherwise all your inequalities which you have in the Hilbert space setting are not there anymore. Cauchy-Schwarz and so relies on positivity. Good, so let me now make a few remarks on this. So we have now that we can realize every distribution by an operator. And of course, the Cauchy transform was a priori defined for operators, but now of course we can say that it's also just can be defined in terms of the mu, because we just take an operator which has the given mu, and then we take the Cauchy transform. And then the Cauchy transform only depends on the moment, so it only depends on the mu. So, here are remarks about this. So first remark is this, so since the g of x, the Cauchy transform, our operator-valued Cauchy transform of an operator-valued random variable x depends only on the distribution of this x, so it only depends on mu of mu x, the distribution of x. We can, of course, label the Cauchy transform also by the distribution instead of x. So we can also write g of x as g mu. For any x which has the distribution mu. So we can also, we have a Cauchy transform for our abstract mu's. And of course I'm saying since this depends only on the distribution, which means it only depends on the moments, maybe this is something you should think a little bit about. So I mean this is might not be so clear directly, but in principle everything we derived, or maybe we should talk about again, I mean, essentially the idea is that, of course, the moments, the Cauchy transform is a power series, and the coefficients about infinity are the moments. So that's also in a classical case. If you have a compactly supported probability measure, then, of course, the Cauchy transform of this measure only depends on the moments. Essentially because about infinity, you have an expansion where the moments are the coefficients. So everything is determined by the moments. And here it should be the same. The Cauchy transform, which a priori is defined as an analytic object, should also have an expansion about infinity, and the coefficients there are the moments. And also all kind of moments if we look on all the various levels. So we expect, somehow clear. So as in the classical case, the moments of our random variable x should be the coefficients in the power series expansion of our Cauchy transform, so of T of X. And yeah, it should be the power series expansion in 1 over set about infinity. So in set to the minus 1 about infinity. Okay, so in a classical case, maybe it's clear what I mean with this. An operator valued case, I mean talking about 1 over set and about infinity, maybe is maybe also somehow clear, but maybe not so clear. So maybe it's better to formulate everything by moving infinity to 0, by going over to 1 over set. So maybe it's better to formulate this phrase, which I just wrote down, so to formulate this at least nicely. It is better to go over to the function g as a function in 1 over set. And then let me call this h. So h of x as a function in set, this is now g of x in set to the minus 1. And this means I'm somehow infinity goes to 0. So and here this is then really, here I can talk about 0. Maybe it's better to talk about 0 than to talk about infinity. So it's better maybe to rephrase things in this setting. Okay, and let us think a little bit more this dependency and this statement that the coefficients show up in the power series expansion. So let us do this in the following proposition where we make this very precise, that actually we can get, or the moments are really the coefficients of this guy in a power series expansion about 0. And actually, of course, we should also first check that this guy has a power series expansion about 0. A priori, the Cauchy transform is defined in the upper half plane. And if I don't assume a boundedness or whatever, then okay, that's all you can do. Usually, in a classical case, for general probability measures, you don't have an expansion about infinity. But of course, if we assume that we have a compact support, then one has a power series expansion about infinity. Or if I go over to this, then this is an expansion about 0. And this, we should check that we also have this in our setting. And then we can ask what are the coefficients in this setting. And I'm claiming those are exactly the moments. And of course, we know how we get the coefficients from such functions. We have this partial derivatives. So we talked about Taylor series, but we have partial derivatives. So we should take derivatives of this function at 0, and I'm claiming those are the power. Those are the moments of x. Yeah, but so let us see precisely what this means. In particular, because moments now is a much bigger thing. It's not just powers of x's, but it's x's where all the b's are in between. And we also have to invoke the higher matrix versions of our functions for dealing with all of them. Okay, but we can make this quite precise in the following proposition. So here's the statement. Yeah, so we have now our usual setting, A, B, and E. B valued C star probability space. So this is B valued C star probability space. So A and B are C star algebras, B is a subalgebra of A, and E is a conditional expectation from A to B. And we consider a self-adjoint variable in A, and we look on its Cauchy transform, and we want to see where are the moments hidden in a Cauchy transform. And as I said, maybe it's better to look on this function. So let me define this. So So then the function hx, which a priori goes from h minus of the matrices over B to h minus of the matrices over B. So h minus is the lower half plane, and so I'm sending z to hx of z. This is just g, but applied to z to the minus 1. And if I take here a z in the lower half plane, then of course z to the minus 1 is in the upper half plane. That's where g of x is defined. And the upper half plane is sent to the lower half plane. So this is a map h minus to h minus. Good. And a priori, it's not defined in zero, or in a ball about zero, but now we are claiming, because we have here bounded operators, actually this function has an extension to a ball about zero, a fully matricial extension. So that's the first point. So, I mean, just without this, I could not talk about coefficients about zero. But so I need that this function really has an extension. And so I'm saying, so first of all, of course, this is also fully matricial, because it's just coming in a direct way from the G. So this is a fully matricial function. But I say I can extend its domain, which has a fully matricial extension to a neighborhood of zero, and actually this is a uniform neighborhood. So usually we need uniform guys. So this means it's a ball which has size in all matrix sizes. So uniform neighborhood of zero. And if I'm taking derivatives of this function about zero, I can recover the moment, so of x. So how do I get the moment? Let's say b zero x, b one, up to b n, x, b n plus one. So I'm claiming this is the same as taking the n plus first derivative, or this delta n plus one of h x. And so this was something which we have to apply. So I have here n plus 1, I have to apply it to n plus 2 arguments, but the arguments are all zero. So here I have only zeros, and then this also has to be applied to a vector of length n plus 1. And there, of course, I'm taking just the b's, which I mean, the b's must show up somewhere here. So I'm making an expansion about zero, but this is somehow, those are partial derivatives in some directions, and I have to apply it to those directions. So this is b0, b1. So this will be applied exactly to n plus 2 guys here. Okay, as many as I have here. Okay. So that's what I'm claiming. Now, for calculating those derivatives, actually we don't have to calculate difference quotients and limits, but we just have to apply our mapping to special matrices, where we are putting those guys on the upper diagonal. So that was somehow the point. I mean, this is in a sense a derivative, but it can also be calculated directly by applying our function to matrices. Good, but so let us check this. So first we should check this extension about zero, and this is of course just the usual calculation which you do with Cauchy transforms, where you expand the geometric series. Yeah, and we just do it in terms of x. Because then we should get nice formulas where really we can also put x or set the variable equal to 0. Yeah, so we do now the power series expansion about 0, and this is actually in a uniform way. So this we can do at the same time for all matrix sizes. The matrix size doesn't really play a role or show up. So we have actually uniformly in n, if n is the matrix size, so I'm looking on Hx of set. And I'm not really writing down the matrix size. So set is now not just in B, it can be matrices over B, but I'm not writing the N here, so it should be clear. So what is this? By definition, this is the Cauchy transform applied to set to the minus one. And the Cauchy transform, definition of this was I'm taking the conditional expectation of my argument, which is now set to the minus one. Then I'm subtracting my variable x, and I'm taking the minus one of this whole thing and then applying e to it. And again, this x actually should be one tensor x because I have to embed things. But I'm just omitting this. And this should be identity tensor e if I'm really on the matrices. But I think all of this should be clear. So I'm writing now things in a more compact form. Good. Okay, so here is a set to the minus one. I have here to the minus one. I want to bring this to the geometric series, so I want to write this as one minus something. So I should take out this set to the minus one. With this minus one, it really comes out as a set. And set is in B or matrix over B, so it goes also out here because E is the identity on B. So what I get here is set times E of, and then I have here one minus x, and here of course I have to correct that I have brought out the set, so here I also need a set, minus one. So I mean this set here goes in, here it appears as a set to the minus one, here it also appears as a set to the minus one from this side, so it cancels this. Then I just have this. So I'm writing this, and now I have here a geometric, I have 1 over 1 minus some operator, and of course I can expand this in a geometric series as long as the norm of this operator is smaller than 1. So I can write this as set times the sum over e to the x set to the power k. And e of course is continuous, so it commutes with this infinite sum. And this is true as long as the geometric series expansion which I have here converges in uniformly. And this is true if the norm is smaller than 1. So this here converges uniformly if the norm of this guy is less than 1, which I can achieve if I make the norm of set small enough. Namely, the norm of set should be smaller than 1 over the norm of x. So you see that if I'm now taking a ball about 0 of such a radius, then I mean this here makes sense, and this is defined. And this ball is now a ball in all matrix sizes, because this estimate here works in the same way for all set of all matrix sizes. So this estimate here tells me that I really have my extension. So thus this function hx has an extension to the ball about 0 of radius 1 over the norm of x. Good, and this means I can also take now derivatives at the point 0, because 0 is now an inner point of my domain, or it's part of my domain now. And yeah, so I can now look on those quantities here. And the question is, how can I see that they are this guy here? And now you should remember that actually, I mean, we have written this as a derivative, and in principle it is a derivative, but on the other hand, we just defined it by applying our function to special special matrices. So the definition of this object here was not by by taking derivatives, but by looking on the action of H on specific matrices. So let me recall this. So note that we have, in general, and I mean in this generality, I mean this was given in one of the assignments, assignment 3, exercise 3. We have that actually this derivative here of my function x, hx, at the point 0 applied to the vector b0 up to bn plus 1. So this is given as applying hx to some matrix and then looking on just one corner in this matrix. So namely, I have to look at the upper right corner. So this is the upper right entry in. I apply this guy here to something. So what do I take? I take the matrix where I'm putting the arguments here on the diagonal. But here the arguments are all zero. So I have just here zero on the diagonal. And the B's on which I act with this, I'm putting it on the next diagonal above. So I'm putting here B0, B1, and so on, up to Bn and Bn plus 1. So this is an n plus 2 times n plus 2 matrix. So I have here n plus 2 zeros. Oh no, actually it's even more. Okay, so... So and I have here n plus 2 b's, so I have actually n plus 3 of the zeros here. Okay, and so I take this matrix, so everything else is zero, and I'm applying hx to this. This is, at least if the b's are small enough, this is a neighborhood of zero, and now we know that this is zero. So we know that this makes sense. And then what we get is, of course, a matrix of the same size where we have a lot of things. But in this corner, what shows up there is exactly what we denoted by this. Okay. And then, of course, in principle, in this assignment, you showed that what shows up here is exactly what you get as a kind of Taylor expansion of your function. So these really are the derivatives. Or in class, we also saw that, at least for the first or second derivative, I mean, it's really the partial derivatives of your function, which you get by this. But if we want to calculate it, we don't have to calculate difference quotients. We just apply our function to this guy here. And if we know how to apply this, then we get these derivatives. And so, I mean, now we can do this. And we have a way of calculating our function as this geometric series, which of course in general might not be so nice because it's an infinite series. But now if we want to apply it to such a matrix, then you see these are special matrices. They are actually nilpotent because if you take powers of such a matrix, and that's what we have to do there, then actually, I mean, after some power, it will be zero, because if you multiply this with itself, essentially the only non-trivial information which is on this diagonal will move to the next one, and so on. And after sufficiently many steps, this guy will be zero. So this infinite sum here, actually, for such matrices, is just a finite sum. This means it might not be so bad to really use this formula. Of course, you could also try to take inverses directly, but I mean calculating inverses of such things is quite a mess. It can be done, but it's quite a mess. So in this case, because we have nilpotent entries here, this is very convenient. So let me note this down here. So since, let me call this argument now set, this will be the argument in which we are interested. So since set is nilpotent, so this means some power of it will be zero. So if I multiply it sufficiently often with itself, it will be zero. So it's nilpotent. We can use the expansion which we just derived here. So h x of z is z times this sum here. So just this expansion here to calculate. This function hx of z. And this expansion will just stop after a number of terms. Good, and so let me do the calculation now for the two simplest cases. So we are claiming this here for all n. Let me do it for n equal to 0 and n equal to 1. So just that we see what we get here. But I mean for general n, it works in the same way. So for n equal to 0, we get the zeroth moment, and for n equal to 1, we get the first moment. So let me see how we get it from here. Maybe for fun, you can calculate the second moment. Yeah, so n equal to 0. So what do we get there? So for n equal to 0, I should calculate hx of 0, 0, and I have 1b, so I put b0 here. So those are the two zeros which I have as arguments in my derivative, and I'm applying it to the b0. So that's what I should calculate here, and then I should look on this entry in the result. This will be the corresponding derivative which I want there. And so what is this? But now this h. So in my sum here, so what do I take? I just have the term k equal to 0, which is just this term here. Let me see. So what do I get? So you see, k equal to 0 means I have one set. If k is bigger, the argument here is set. So this and this is set. So if k is bigger, I'm multiplying at least the set two times. But if I multiply this guy here with itself, it will be 0. So here I only have the first term, the term corresponding to k equal to 0, which is just, just the set. And all the other terms in this series, they will be 0, because they involve at least two sets. But so you see, the only thing which I have here, now I have to look for this guy, and this is b0. So this means that the delta, so I'm taking the derivative of hx at 0, 0, applied to b0. So that's the guy which I get here, if I apply hx to this matrix, this is actually equal to b0, which of course is the same as e of b0. That's somehow the zeroth moment. This is saying that e is the identity on b. So e applied to b0 is always e, that's the identity. So that's okay. That's how it should be. And now, maybe more interesting, a bit more interesting, is n equal to 1. So what is for n equal to 1? So there we should apply hx to which matrix? To the matrix, it's now a 3 by 3 matrix. I have the zeros on the diagonal. And here I put my b0 and my b1. That's the general result. And now I should plug this into my geometric series. And in this case, of course, this guy here, I can multiply it once with itself. Then there's still something there. But if I multiply it three times or more, it will be 0. So I only get the first two terms there. So if I call this set, let's say, then what I get, the first term is set. That was the one which survived here. And the next term is z times, and then I get e of x times z. And the next term involves z to the power 3, so this is 0. And so what do we get? And of course what we have to look at is the result in this corner. So you see this set here doesn't have anything here, so this doesn't contribute. So the only contribution we get comes from here. And this here, of course, I mean e of xz is the same, of course, as ex times z. So what I have here really is now I'm multiplying z, which is this 3x3 matrix, with x. X now also has to be interpreted as a 3x3 matrix, so I have embed x into the 3x3 matrix by putting it on the diagonal. So what would I then taking e of this? So what this here really means, I have e of x on the diagonal, and then I'm multiplying it with z again. So that's what I have to calculate here. Okay, and of course z is this, and now you see if I multiply this, and then, I only get something which has a result here. So namely this multiplication here, this will be zero everywhere. I can only get a result here, which comes from this b0 times e of x, and then this set here multiplies with the b1. So what I get here is actually b0 e of x b1, and all the other guys are zero. And this here is exactly what we should check. That's my derivative. So this means that what I have to take here is the second derivative of hx at the point 0, 0, 0 applied to b0, b1, which means I should take hx, apply it to this matrix, and then look in the result into this corner. And what I get in this corner is now b0 e of x b1, which of course is the same as e of b0 x b1, because e is a conditional expectation, has a bimodular property. So I can bring in this b0 and this one. And so you see this is the first moment of x for any choice of b0 and b1. So if you really go over to those 3x3 matrices, because I can put different b's here, here and here, I get the full information about the first moment. And so you could do the same if you want to do the next, if you want to get the second moment, then you should take a matrix, a 4x4 matrix, where you have b0, b1 and b2 here. And calculate this, and then you will see in the upper left corner, you get exactly the corresponding moment in the axis. Yeah, okay, so this shows it for n equal to 0 and 2, and in the same way, it's for general n. It's just matrix multiplication with such nilpotent matrices. Of course, in general, using this geometric series for calculating the Cauchy transform is not so good, because the formula will not stop. But if we are dealing with nilpotent guys, and that's really what we are doing if we want to calculate those derivatives, at least at the point 0, then we really have a very nice structure there. Good. Yeah, so this shows that really the Cauchy transform depends on the moments of my distribution, and we also have a nice way to getting out the moments. So it's really the power expansion about infinity, and the coefficients there are the moments. And if we go to all matrix sizes, we really get all moments. Okay, and now somehow we have seen that for our distributions in the class sigma b 0, our Cauchy transform has those nice properties. In particular, it has an extension about infinity, in this way. And in a classical setting, there are characterizations of Cauchy transforms, which tell that if we have analytic functions with this and this property, actually they are Cauchy transforms. And here we have the same. So namely, essentially, this extension about infinity is something which we need. And then, in addition, a Cauchy transform also should have the right behavior if you go to infinity. But that's enough. So let me formulate this. And we have an analog of this in our operator valued setting. So that's the more or less the last thing which I want to do in this general chapter on the Cauchy transform. Good. So let me first remark that Cauchy transforms have this property, but in addition, we also know that they have more specific property at infinity. So in addition to the analyticity property, which we just derived, property from 4.11, so our Cauchy transform of x has also a specific leading order. For set going to infinity. So namely, if you look on it, actually the g of x of set, the first leading order is actually just set. And then for set, it's set to the minus 1 plus something, or if we do it in terms of h, it's set plus some other terms. Okay, and again, maybe it's not so clear what this means, so this is the leading order term. Maybe more precisely, we can phrase it as a limit, or more precisely. So if I take a sequence of sets which converge somehow to infinity, then set k times gx, and let me say it here in n, if I'm on the nth level, so I have it for all levels, but let us take a sequence on a fixed level, that this should converge to 1 in the n by n matrices over b for any sequence which essentially goes to infinity. What do I mean with going to infinity in the operator valued in this matrix over B? So I mean for any sequence set K in the n by matrices over B for which the norm of set K to the minus 1 goes to 0. So that's what I'm meaning here with that set K goes to infinity. Okay, for such, I have this limit, which means essentially that gx behaves like 1 over set. Okay, that's of course also something which is clear from our definition of the Cauchy transform. And actually, this condition and the one which we had before are now really sufficient to characterize the Cauchy transform in our class. So that's what I want to say. So those properties, so this analyticity property, which we had in this proposition before, and this behavior at infinity are actually sufficient to characterize Cauchy transforms for mu in our class of distributions which are exponentially bounded. And I want to write down the precise statement about this, but maybe let me recall that, of course, in a classical context, we also have a characterization of Cauchy transforms, which are very similar to this. So maybe let me first recall this and then give you the operator valued analog. Yeah. Okay, so this is classical case. So recall classical version scalar valued 1. So this says that if we have an analytic function which maps the upper half plane to the lower half plane, then it is already very close to being a Cauchy transform. So in general, I just need that it has the right behavior at infinity. So let G be a mapping from C plus to C minus, be an analytic function. Of course, it should be analytic, which is of course a strong condition to map as an analytic function the upper half plane to the lower. So be an analytic function. Okay, in general, it's not a Cauchy transform. I need a little bit more. And what I need is that it has this kind of behavior at infinity. At infinity, it should be like 1 over the variable. And in the classical case, it's enough to check this if you go on the imaginary axis to infinity. So Iy times g of Iy should converge to 1 as you are running over the imaginary axis, so y is here a real number, so Iy is running over the imaginary axis such that y goes to infinity. Okay, and in principle, this is enough for Cauchy transforms, but if we want compactly Cauchy transforms of compactly supported measures, then of course we have the same as before, that we also have an expansion about infinity. So the second point is the expansion about infinity. Let us again phrase it in terms of the function where I replace the argument by 1 over the argument. So this function h has an analytic continuation to a neighborhood of 0. That's in terms of the Cauchy transform, just saying that the Cauchy transform can be defined in a ball about infinity, which means outside a sufficiently small ball. Okay, here I'm just going to a neighborhood of 0. Good, so if I have this, so if I have a function like this, then the classical statement is that then actually such a function is the Cauchy transform of a probability measure which has compact support. Then there exists a probability measure, and of course this is necessarily uniquely determined. Uniquely determined compactly supported probability measure. Okay, to be precise, let's say Borel probability measures. We're only looking on Borel measures. Probability measure mu on the real numbers on R, such that the given function little g is actually the Cauchy transform of this measure mu. So this means in a classical setting, of course, these are just functions in the complex plane. So g of z is the integral over 1 of z minus t d mu t. Good. Okay, and this part 2, my condition on this analytic continuation is exactly the condition that my measure is compactly supported. So in a classical case, we even have more, namely if you have an analytic mapping from C plus to C minus, which has this right behavior at infinity, then one knows that it is the Cauchy transform of a probability measure without any condition on the support. Good, in the operator valued setting, of course, I mean, it would be nice to have a characterization where we only have the analog of this, but this is the problem of unbounded operators and all those things, and at the moment we cannot really control this. So in the operator valued setting, we have an analog of this theorem here, where we require this and this. Okay, and this theorem was done by John Williams a couple of years ago, and so let me write it down and give you a very rough idea of the proof. So again, I'm not want to go into details, but at least maybe give you again some ideas. So, here's the theorem. So this is by John Williams from 2013. And of course we have always a fixed B, so we are talking about things over B. So let B be a unital C-star algebra. And now we consider a matricial function over B. So we assume we have a G, which of course now is a collection of functions, one for each matrix size. So this should be a fully matricial function, G, defined where Cauchy transforms are defined, namely on the upper half plane of all the matrices to the lower half plane. So we assume, here we have made the assumption it's an analytic function. Fully matricial means it's an analytic, a non-commutative analytic function. And now, we want to make the corresponding requirements about this. And then, of course, the statement is, then it is the Cauchy transform of some distribution. So such that, we have exactly the two analogs of this. So first, the right behavior at infinity. And so we require it in exactly the same form as I had written it before. So it's not enough to go in one direction to infinity, but now we have to require it in all directions. There are many more directions in C-star algebras and matrices over them. So we require that ZK times GN of ZK converges to 1. If I'm on the nth level, I'm taking a sequence of arguments which are living in the n by n matrices over B, and all this here happens in the n by n matrices over B. And for any sequence which goes to infinity, for any sequence ZK in the n by n matrices over B, which goes to infinity in the sense that the norm of ZK to the minus 1 goes to 0. Good. So that's the analog of this condition here, the right behavior at infinity. And it would be nice to find a characterization, what this here means, without the boundedness condition. It should mean that this is the Cauchy transform of distributions, maybe in our class sigma b, but those we don't really control. So we don't have a statement about this. But what we can say, if in addition we require this here, this which corresponds to the boundedness. So again, we replace the argument by 1 over the argument, and then we get a new function, which of course is again fully matricial. So the fully matricial function, let me call it H, which is a collection of HNs for each matrix size, which is of course defined by HN of Z. This is just GN of Z to the minus 1. So this guy, which a priori is now a fully matricial function from the lower half plane to the lower half plane, and I'm requiring that this has a matricial extension to a neighborhood of 0. So that this has a fully matricial extension to a uniform neighborhood of 0. So that's, I'm requiring the analog of those two things, and then the statement is exactly as in the classical case, that under such conditions, this function g actually must be the Cauchy transform of some operator-valued distribution on B. So then, the g actually is the Cauchy transform of some mu, which comes from our class of distributions for operators in B-valued C-star probability spaces. So for some mu from this class sigma B0. Yeah, good. Okay, so maybe time is more or less over, but so maybe I just say in two or three sentences the sketch of the proof. So maybe I wanted to give a sketch anyhow, so maybe it can be even more sketchy. Of course, so what you have to do is that you have to get the mu out of the g. And I mean, in our proposition, which I now erased before, we saw if I have a Cauchy transform, how I get the moments out of the Cauchy transforms. So I should take the derivatives at the point zero applied to this vector b. So I have now a function g, so which has this extension about zero, so I can take the derivatives at zero. And so it is clear how I should define my mu, just by taking the derivatives of this function. But then, of course, it remains to check that the mu, which I get by this definition, has the properties which it should have for mu in this class. Okay, and I mean, some of them are quite straightforward. Of course, the crucial thing is the positivity. So, I mean, I have to see that the numbers, or the distribution which I get here, really has the positivity properties which I need for distributions. And this is a non, maybe, yeah, this can be done, but it's most non-trivial. And actually, you do this by reducing your situation back to the classical setting. So you use the classical theorem. I mean, even the classical theorem is not, I mean, this is not a straightforward thing. So it tells you that if you have a function which has this property, and then you do the expansion about zero, that there, the coefficients which you get there is actually a positive definite sequence of numbers, which is not so clear. You don't see this directly from these properties, that you have a mapping which goes from the upper half plane to the lower half plane, and you make this expansion, that the numbers which you get in this expansion really has some positivity properties. So, I mean, the proof of this classical theorem is not easy. Okay, and here, so you reduce it. So you're not giving a new proof of the classical theorem, but you're using the classical theorem by essentially checking or reducing things which you get here to the classical situation. And how do you do this? I mean, here you have mappings which go, let's say, on the symbols level from B to B. And you would like to check positivity of things. So if you have an element in B, how can you check positivity? You can check positivity by applying all possible states to B and check whether the number, which you think should be positive, is mapped to a positive number. But if you apply your states to your function G, you get actually a function which lives in C. So you're building out of your functions which you have here, actually functions which go from C to C, and then you check that those functions satisfy the classical properties, because, I mean, the functions which you have here satisfy these versions here, and that the reduction which you do for the classical case don't destroy this. But going down to the classical situation, I mean, that's what you do very often if you're dealing with analytic functions on operator spaces. You can control this by applying positive or linear functionals to your mappings, and then control what happens under those linear functions. And for our C-star algebras, I mean, element in the C-star algebra is positive if it is positive as a complex number under all applications of states. Okay, and so maybe I'm not saying more about this. Good, so this is a non-trivial theorem, but it's good that we have this. It tells that our notations are, in a sense, meaningful generalizations of what we have in a classic context, and that they fit together in the right way. So I think I will stop here with talking about this analytic functions, fully matricial functions and Cauchy transforms. And then next time, I really want to go into more free probability territory by really bringing some more structure into non-commutative distributions by the notion of freeness. So good. Okay, so that's it for today.